The vlog for today is entitled No Matter What. No matter what. And now I'll go up to the wildlife camera and get the SD card and see if there's any wildebeest for you on there. See, friends, this is a wildlife camera. It has two sensors, one for video and one for stills. Infrared light here for night, and then two motion sensors, one infrared and one normal, that sends the object up to 30 feet in front of it. It's connected to an external battery, a small motorcycle battery, in a casing that is watertight. Can sit up here for 1 year. And whatever is on the SD card inside this camera, this you'll see today. And they had eaten some very rotten, very smelly, extreme smelly dry fish I use as a bait. So they are carnivore, they are predators. And since the camera is here and I put the dry fish there, and there's 1.5 meter down there, then it's something that either can climb or is more than 1.5 meter standing up. Can it be Mr. Leo that's been on his way here? The target animal, the target species, the Sri Lankan leopard, the world largest leopard, 80-90 kilo, 7 feet from nose tip to tail tip, who is roaming around these forests, up and down these hills. Mr. Leo, Mr. Leo, come to Papa. We'll see. I used 1 year on this project, maybe today, but I think maybe it's a wild boar. The father. But could also be a very large species of rat called a Maha Urumia, the big pig rat, 0.5 meter long. We'll see. Mr. Leo, Mr. Leo, come on. Here you got the camera. There's a cockroach in there. Ah, there's a whole family. They have made it their new house. They had made experiments with cockroaches, whether they can count or not. And cockroaches can count. They're very social. You can see they live in the same house. So if you make a cockroach, there can be exactly 50 cockroaches inside. A house that can be exactly, so they sit by themselves. Then they stay in there. Then you put one house down, there's 25. Can be 25 cockroaches. And another house in the same case can also be 25 cockroaches. Then exactly 25 cockroaches move into the other house. Exactly. 25 cockroaches. Exactly the half of 50. And if you do the same thing with a house for 100 cockroaches, or a house for 200 cockroaches, and you put have a big house and then you put two small houses with there can be exactly 100 cockroaches in each, then exactly the same thing. Exactly 100 cockroaches move to the other house. And that is why we know that this gentleman, Mr. Cockroach, can't count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So there's a lot of these guys. Sapisata bhavantu sukhitata. May all beings become thus happy. Guys, you have to move out for just a moment because I have to replace the car. Then you can come into the house again in a short while. I'm sorry for the disturbance. He's not giving up his house so easily. See, friends, out here among these mossy cracks and small mountain streams, I'm in a favorite spot. And here behind me is a endemic wild ground orchid called Phaios tangavillae, or the nun orchid, which is a very large cluster, typically standing here near a stream. So they like to stand with wet feet, and it's in full bloom, as I show you now. It's in full bloom. Fairly large flowers, as you will see, in the order of 5-7 centimeters, and really beautiful, in my opinion. Wild ground orchid opinion. Thank you. There we are, another favorite spot, the fairy spot inside the jungle, with large boulders, cracks, moss, and all kinds of leaves and animals, and a lot of cardamom, which you see here planted by here. This is cardamom, planted 100 years ago. So it's been utilized as a spice garden. But now to the vlog. I just set up the tripod first. Thank you. See, this, my friends, is some of our friends. Peculiar phenomena here to Sri Lanka. Leeches, blood-sucking leeches that lives on land. And they are very, very interested in my blood, as you see. And this is one of the only annoyances you have out here and in the forest, is this. But they're almost full now. Blood-sucking leeches. See, this is a really large fellow. It's full of blood. It's uses for laying eggs. Now he'll go and find the hermaphrodite, but nevertheless he will go if he can find a mate. Hello to you, friends. Video log number 28, directly from the cool jungle, mountain jungle of Knuckles Mountain, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka, near Bambarella. No matter what. Namo. Tasso. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy. Honorable. And perfectly self-enlightened. Was a blessed Buddha. Indeed. Why no matter what? Actually. Because death is not the end. No matter what. Except Nirvana. Then death is the happy end. Otherwise, death starts with here a new beginning, and then comes a new life. Baby, child, youth, troublesome adulthood, work, pension, and death again, and then back to square one, and then again. So death is not the end. Death is not the end. And so this means they are going in circles, basically. Sometimes, mostly low circles here and there, as the blood leeches you see here. And they are going around sucking blood on various monks and people and whoever comes by, deers. And you have also done, and I also done that for billions of times. And we've also been humans for billions of times. So this repeat life and death is not that that is no matter what. Because that's a trivial, banal repeat of the CD or MP3. Huh? Just repeat. Well, it's not exactly the same as repeats, but it is more or less the same. Well, what is then no matter what? The Dhamma is no matter what. And I tell you why. Because there's a hell of a difference whether you're circling around here in the screaming barbecue, like here like a leech, like here like a human, or higher than a deva, or you go fully out. There's a hell of a difference, literally speaking, because leech, they cannot see much and have to eat others' blood and a lot of dirt. Humans, we can see a little more, hear a little more, understand a little more. They have higher degrees of freedom, but we cannot fly. And we cannot change our own form. And we age inevitably. So no matter what, it's good to think about when you are hit by unfortunate events like disease, sickness, whether it kills you or not, that's not the issue. No matter what, the Dhamma is the issue. The Dhamma is more important because that determines where you are going, where you are heading up or down. Higher pleasure, higher beauty, higher degrees of freedom, higher ability to understand, or lower, in the ultimate sense, barbecue screaming. Very low degrees of freedom does not have one single moment, can be for millions of years. 10,000 of years is not unusual. They don't have one single neutral or pleasant moment in all this time. Only torture, you know. Few can cope with that, if anybody at all. And in the other extreme is the devas, to sit the devas, said to be the best place in the Kamaloka, in the lower third of the 31 levels of existence, namely level 10, and we are in level 5. And even higher, it's even better, made of light, and there's only joy and laughter. So bliss can have many degrees, and they're usually mixed up with peace and ease. Because otherwise this contentment, sanctuti, doesn't arrive. So, just this much is needed. Noble Eightfold Way. That's needed. No matter what, remember that. Because all the other things are just passing ephemeral, blah, 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 up and down. The doorway, same story as last time. Last year, last life, last universe. Huh? The path is no matter what. Because that is the only thing that can bring you one upwards on this ladder, 31 steps ladder of freedom. And eventually, let the ladder go and go scot-free. So you escape this sansaric prison of pride, joy, envy, buzzing around, anger, desire, and what have you. So you don't need to see more Dhamma videos with monks talking in the forest, and bees and flies buzzing around to taste human blood. You don't. So, what comes right after death, after this death, that most beings think, this is the ultimate end. You know, when I die, then it's everything finished. It's so terrible that I don't even dare think about it. No, death is not the end. It's just like this moment. This moment also dies. the moment of this material thing, this psychophysical mental matter conjunction, nama rupa, mind and matter junction, meeting, conditional relation, linking. This mind and matter linking with the internal, conventionally called me, or externally, conventionally called you, or even more externally called the physical world, jungle. Well, then this, when this moment goes down, then a new moment arises. And when this moment goes down, then a new moment arises. And so also it happens after death. What determines what will be in the next moment was conditioned by the prior moment, which was conditioned by the prior moment, a prior moment all the way back, which there's no discernible beginning. So it's a contiguous, not continuous, but contiguous blinking of mental and material moments. That is existence. And we have a chance to shape it. We do it whether we like it or not, whether we know it or not, whether we can understand it or not, then we form intentions, which is the same thing as saying that we are generating probabilities, likelihoods, potentialities for certain futures to arise, moments of future to arise with specific contents like jungle or city or beautiful or ugly or rich or poor or whatever, pain or pleasure, famous or insignificant. This we conditions by what? By the intentional content of our consciousness. Thereby we produce future. The trees round here does not produce future. Neither for themselves. You can say in some sense, maybe when they flower and so on, they produce a continuation, but it's not of themselves, nor is it of anybody else. And the same thing with us. We also form future. They form it by seeds and shoots. We form it by intentions, which is just like making seeds and seeding the future. Just like laying eggs or putting shoots down like a potato in the ground or a ginger rhizome, and then it'll grow. The Buddha once told a man, and the man came walking through, and then he said, you know, I don't create any future. He explain why? What if, let's say, imagine you are going out in a jungle, in a desert, and you are going along, it's just desert, samsaric desert, and then suddenly you turn around and see a jungle like this, and so then you say to yourself, how come that? And then I will say to you, I look in your pockets, there's a hole in your pockets, and they were full of seeds, so you've been dripping out seeds. And now when you turn around, you can see the junk that you planted yourself. If we just in worse situation, the unaware individual is going backwards, seeing jungle in front of him without noticing it, without seeing it. And thereafter going at it into it gradually, little by little, himself or herself. So, of course, it depends what you see. You will only see what you see. You will only enjoy what you plant. You will only reap what you sow. So, since this sowing of these future seeds is probability that are non-local, everywhere present from the moment they are formed by consciousness, then they are everywhere present, so wherever you go, you will meet these echoes. Probabilistic, probability, likelihood, potential echoes. That basically when projected up at the screen of consciousness, becomes events of visual consciousness, auditory consciousness, olfactory consciousness, gustatory consciousness, tactile consciousness, and mental consciousness of ideas and mental states. So no matter what, it's important to know what you're seeding. You can only seed things that will become larger degrees of freedom, higher beauty, higher strength, higher intelligence, and eventually escape, release, liberation, emancipation, if developing the Noble Eightfold Way. Arya Atangika Magga. That's the only way. And the only way to the purification and development and fulfillment of that Noble Eightfold Way is to be aware. Sati. To be present in every moment. So no moment slip by. In this way you are aware of every moment. You have a chance at least to evaluate whether the intentional content of your consciousness is expressing greed, hate, or ignorance, or derivatives thereof like jealousy, envy, opposition, anger, doubt, uncertainty, hesitation, and so forth. Because then this future will eventually be unsuccessful, painful, unpleasant, frustrated. But if you know for sure, by evaluating and by skillful driving this mind, hands on wheel, huh? Looking forward, on the road, ahead, whether it contains death or not, is not the issue. Death is not the issue. Well, then you can shape these future seeds coming out by the 100,000 billion per second, whether they will be tainted or not tainted, whether there will be completely non-ignorance, that is, knowing and seeing and interpreting this show in the framework of the Four Noble Truths. All this is suffering. The cause is, this suffering is craving. Absence of craving is end of suffering. And for the Noble Eightfold Way, it's the way, the path, the method, the cookbook to reach the end of suffering, Nibbana, deathlessness, neither more nor less. So, what comes right out after the death is all the accumulated moments we have shaped in this life and in former lives by being mostly unaware, unfortunately. And if we become aware, we can accumulate something that after death will be better than this on a higher degree of freedom. And we will seed the Noble Eightfold Way. So when we come into our next life with such a big devotion, bhakti and faith, saddha and conviction, confirmed conviction, that maybe we'll not remember it after we have passed through, before we have passed through our teenage years, but we will keep an eye on it and then eventually find it again. When we find the path again, well, it starts going higher again, and then next life higher again. Maybe we're a little bit downfall and then higher again, a little bit downfall. So it's one step backwards and two forwards, not the opposite way around. If you take one step backwards in your youth, crashes a little bit, but then you start developing the path in your, let's say, late 20s, and then in old age, approaching death, then you come much higher in that life. This means that you start over here fairly high in the new life. That's the way. That's the way, no matter what. Just the path, the Noble Eightfold Way is needed. The rest is junk. Drop it. Let it go. No matter what. nothing is worth clinging to. Repeat, nothing is worth clinging to, except the path, but that only until arahantship. Arahatta phala, the fruit of enlightenment has been experienced, then one can let go also of the path itself. It's not needed anymore, but not before. One who drinks deep the Dhamma lives happily with a tranquil mind. The wise one ever delights in the Dhamma made known by the noble ones. Dhammapada 79. Irrigators regulate the rivers. Fletchers stretching the arrows. Carpenters, they flatten the planks and shape the wood. The wise one control themselves. The wise ones control themselves. Whether here, there, 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 or everywhere. No matter what. Dhammapada 79 and Dhammapada 80 of the Buddha, which you see here. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Remember to subscribe so you get your ticket to Nirvana. Thank you to all the good spiritual friends out there, the helpers, the donors, the givers, the feeders, and whoever take up the path. Thank you. And may you indeed have a nice, beautiful, cool and noble day, no matter what. No matter what, I'll strive to never kill even a single conscious being ever again. Neither now nor later. No, much later, I'll strive with all I got never to kill again. I'll strive with all I got to tell and recommend and explain to others never to kill again. In that way, I offer protection to all beings. No matter what, I will strive and disentangle so much as I can, so I never take what is not given again, so that I never steal anything again. No matter what, I'll strive courageful, smart, intelligent when I tell others not to steal again, not to misappropriate values, not to cheat with anything. No matter what, I'll strive never to abuse other beings sexually or or when I'm taking pleasure in any other way. I'll strive with all I got to avoid all forms of sexual abuse, no matter what. I would urge, explain to others and recommend to avoid all sexual abuse, no matter what. I'll take a far and tricky side road to avoid all lying, avoid all speaking of falsehood, all pretending. All gossiping, all idle chatter, but first of all, deliberate lying. No matter what, I'll strive with all I got to avoid that, to stop that, to cut that out. And no matter what, I will defend to the very last this principle of honesty. I'll defend it to myself. I'll stand up to it. And I will defend it to other beings as well. No matter what, no matter what, I'll strive with all I got, as if death were right in front of me, to avoid all intoxicants, all polluting of this fickle and tricky mind, no matter what. Whatever intoxicants they come to with me and suggest I should enjoy, whether alcohol, booze, fine wine, fancy champagne, skunk, pot, marijuana, ganja, ecstasy, LSD, cocaine, crack, opioids, benzodiazepines, tranquilizers, no matter what, I'll avoid that. Why so? Because I know with absolute certainty that despite it looks like happiness, it leads only one way, down. It is ruin. It is a complete insanity, no matter what. No matter what, I will encourage, raise up, reinforce, help all my friends and all I meet to do the same thing. To avoid all killing. To avoid all stealing. To avoid all lying and pretending. To avoid all sexual abuse. And to avoid all intoxicants. Because why? Because I know for sure that is the only and first step towards lasting happiness. No matter what, having taken this first step on the Noble Eightfold Way, I'll keep going forward. Yes, there will be relapses. Yes, there will be downfalls here and there. Some even all the way down to the screaming barbecue, but I'll raise up again. I'll be the ultimate comeback kid. I'll never give up. I'll never give up. No matter what. Huh? Friends, you got that right? Never give up. no matter what. Come back to the Noble Eightfold Way. Take a walk in the forest. Think about it. Go back. Take a shower. Sit on the pillow. Reflect on it. Meditate on it. Then it is self-evident, obvious, and ultra clear-cut that this is, always was, and remains so forever, the ultimate truth of that business called life. Huh? And since we still have this precious Satdhamma here on planet Earth, we should utilize it and reinforce it by these forest walks and these book studies and these reflections on the pillow and this purification of all mental, verbal, and bodily activity, behavior, and actions. Whether our own or others, or both our own and others. That's what we should do. Whack. That's what we should do. Whack in the face. That's what comes. That's what goes. No matter. Almost no matter what. And now we approach the end of the forest, and then I'm fairly anxious to see whether Mr. Leo and his nice dotted appearances is on the SD card, so we can see him, how beautiful he is in his impressive fur. And that indeed, no matter what, ends in a new continuation. Oops. The Dhamma. No. The vlog. The video log number 28. For the benefit of all beings. And now we are out. And over there, you see the knuckles. And goodbye.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy. Thereby, thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution. And have a nice day.